Hello and welcome to Stand in the Gap. I'm Sam Rohr, and I'll be joined again today by Pastor Isaac Crockett as we conclude our focus on deception. Jesus Christ himself warned about deception in Matthew 24 as being the lead mark of the end days. The reality of deception, as warned about throughout the entire New Testament in the book of Jude and by the apostles John and Paul, is real, and we're now seeing it all around us. Our theme for the last program and now part two in this program is Deception Alert, Wolves in Sheep's Clothing Inside the Church. Now, in part one, we highlighted one wolf strategy targeted primarily at infiltrating evangelical churches in America with the Marxist social gospel message, with the goal of altering the way Christians primarily in the southern red states will vote. This organization we identified as the AND Campaign, which boasts the vision statement, which includes the phrase, to disrupt America's socio-political arena. While the vision and mission of the AND Campaign are cleverly couched within some biblical terms, including the phrase, asserting the justice and righteousness of Jesus Christ, they in reality promote the clear objectives of socialism and big government, the core ideology of Marxism. The other leg of the most aggressive wolf strategy deception targeting the church in America is Islam. Working hand in hand with the Marxist social justice philosophy, Islam has invaded the church using very similar appeals. In this program, we'll look inside one lead organization calling itself Neighborly Faith that has on its website these words, quote, the trusted platform for bringing evangelicals and Muslims together, end quote. And while sounding harmless enough on the surface, this vision, again, must be defined in order to be understood. The Marxist element of the AND campaign, using the phrase asserting the justice and righteousness of Jesus Christ, was cleverly concealed, for instance, until you saw the socialist and Marxist policies this supposed Christian group requiring for 2020 candidates' support, including these 4 points: anti-poverty programs, support of racial equity, support of religious liberty, but get this, interpreted, including protection for LGBTQ people in the workplace and housing, and then health care for all, and number 5, just and compassionate immigration policies. All of these code words for Marxism. Well, the same level of deception, and maybe even more, exists for this organization called Neighborly Faith that lists what we believe section on their website, which reads very biblically consistent with a true view of God, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, verbally inspired scriptures, and sin and salvation. But then on the same website, it promotes members and spokespeople for this organization, which includes leading Islamic leaders who are committed to Sharia law and directly connected to the Muslim Brotherhood and Islamic jihadist organizations committed to destroying Israel and subjugating all of Christianity. So to continue our discussion now is our special guest, Brannon Howse, president and founder of Worldview Weekend Radio and TV. Welcome back to the program, Brannon.
Thank you so much for having me on, Sam.
Brannon, in brief, as we move into this now, this last part two of this program, what is this group's mission and their primary message? Effectively, what message are they trying to communicate to the evangelical, to the Christian community generally at large?
I believe it's a very deceptive message that basically says if you're going to be a good neighbor and invoke a lot of scripture out of context, then you're going to be involved in interfaith dialogue, which is very dangerous. Jesus himself has warned about, as you said, the wolves that will rise from within. And we see so-called pastors and folks from Christian organizations, historically Christian organizations, promoting this. And yet we also see in 2 Corinthians 6:14-18, what fellowship does righteousness have with unrighteousness, light with darkness? You can't do this. We see Ephesians 5:11, to expose these things. Romans 16, 17, mark those who cause divisions doctrinally and avoid them. So again, the goal is to convince Christians that it's biblical, it's loving, it's tolerant to be involved in interfaith dialogue, which by its very nature is unbiblical because you cannot mix truth and error. You cannot mix Islam and Christianity. And the people doing this, by the way, are open members of Muslim Brotherhood, an organization that dates all the way back to 1928 and was involved in organizing, and one of the architects of the Holocaust with Adolf Hitler was a Muslim Brotherhood representative, al-Husseini, the Grand Mufti of Palestine. So think about this. Christians in America now are going to try to find common ground with people that carried out the Holocaust. These are Islamic neo-Nazis. That is not an extreme statement. If you know their history, what they believe, what they proclaim, these are claiming Jews are pigs, they're apes, they need to be destroyed. They align themselves with Hitler. They went all the way to the point of interpreting Mein Kampf, Hitler's book, into Arabic, calling it my jihad. So again, this is Islamic neo-Nazis, now well-known evangelicals and evangelical organizations are aligning themselves with, saying we can find some kind of interfaith dialogue or common ground. Not possible.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is, in fact, an example of a wolf strategy, this Islamic penetration, using good words, working with people who actually would say they believe in Jesus Christ and are advancing the righteousness of Jesus Christ, but impossible. When we come back, we're going to examine a little bit of this interfaith dialogue piece of where they are pushing, where they're trying to go, and we'll try to detail, best of our ability here, why this strategy is so dangerously deceptive.
Truth, flexible or permanent? The Bible, ancient history or powerfully relevant? Culture, a reflection of enlightenment or warning signs? The pastor, commentator or frontline combatant? Every day, American Pastors Network speaks to these questions where and when they matter. With hundreds of affiliate radio stations nationwide, a website and mobile app screening today's headlines through the twin lenses of the Bible and the Constitution. Educating, informing, equipping. This is the American Pastors Network. The time is now to stand in the gap for truth.
Welcome back to Stand in the Gap, and we're talking with our friend Brannon Howse, and we've been looking at deceptive tactics, ways that groups are trying to infiltrate not just the church at large in America, but specifically targeting conservative, Bible-believing groups, the evangelical church in America. And we're talking about a group called Neighborly Faith. And Brannon, I hear Neighborly Faith, and it makes me think of statements, you know, that Jesus made, like, love your neighbor as yourself. I think of the story of the Good Samaritan who, you know, helps this Jewish man when even his own people wouldn't help him. And they conjure up a lot of positive images that way. They use a lot of words that we use doctrinally. You look at their stuff, and it's looking pretty good. But you brought up that some of the people that they have representing them right off the bat give kind of a red flag. A couple of the people they have as a spokesperson, first one is Zainab Chaudhry. She's identified and pictured with a full head covering, the hijab covering. The website says that she's the spokeswoman and director of Maryland Outreach for the Counsel on American Islamic Relations. That's CARE. That's a group that we've talked about on here before that's connected with a lot of terror groups. It's the nation's largest Muslim civil rights group. Another person here on the Neighborly Faith site is Islamic spokesperson Dalia Magahed. She's identified in the past as having made some statements more or less defending some of the harsh parts of Sharia law, like caning and stoning. She says that Sharia should be viewed as I believe her words were a framework for achieving a more just society and ironically protection of human rights she gets from Sharia, and that it's a rule of law. So Brannon, what these spokespersons that they have that are obviously from the Muslim side of things, it seems opposite of their scriptural, you know, integrity that they claim to have. These statements and these two leaders here working with Neighborly Faith, What does that show us about their true mission, and what does that show us about what this group really is all about?
Well, the last lady you mentioned, she worked directly with Barack Obama when he was president, so that'll also tell you a lot about her worldview. But the fact that these guys are and gals are working with Muslim Brotherhood, which again is CARE, which is also Hamas. Remember, CARE was started in 1928. Hamas was started in 1987, a terrorist wing, and CARE was started in 1994 here in America. So know what you're working with. They call Jews pigs and apes. They are behind the BDS as well, boycott, divestment, sanctions. This is nothing more than what set up the Holocaust, boycotting the Jews, known as the Night of Kristallnacht, breaking their shop windows and hauling their men off to the concentration camps, the beginning of the Holocaust. What are these groups now doing? They're boycotting, and they know they can't destroy Israel economically. So what they're doing is carrying out a gigantic propaganda campaign to justify the persecution of Jews and anti-Semitism on a global scale. Now, I ask, how can so-called evangelicals find any kind of common ground with that? Now, people want to talk about being neighborly. How about the Muslims try to be neighborly to the Jews? But no, here in America, one imam after another talks about wiping out the Jews, calls them names, constantly talking about how we need to destroy them, no Israel, wipe them into the sea. Where is the neighborly? Where are these, dare I say, historical term by Lenin, where are these useful idiots when it comes to, within evangelicalism, calling for the Muslims to act in a neighborly way toward both the Christians and the Jews? This is a tactic of Syed Qutb, one of the leading Muslim Brotherhood scholars, who said that the interfaith dialogue was a one-way bridge to bring the non-Muslim to their side, not the other way around. So if you want to be neighborly evangelical Christians, don't let the Muslim think that when they worship Allah, who's really Satan, that's going to get them to heaven. If the loving thing is what you want to do, share the true gospel with them. You need to know the Quran. Explain to them the lies in the Quran, the double standards in the Quran, the inconsistencies in the Quran, and then explain to them the personal Jesus Christ who came to earth. Allah would never have a son. He would never become a human being. He would never lay down his life for anyone. Yet Jesus Christ did, God incarnate, Emmanuel, God with us. So if you want to be loving, share the gospel. But otherwise, you're being a useful idiot to help to destroy and de-Christianize the West. That's the goal, de-Christianize the West. And the Marxists are using the Islamists to create chaos, de-Christianize the West, and target those that embrace a Judeo-Christian worldview, which is who? The Jews and the Christians. That's who's being targeted. And who's bringing them in here? The Marxists. To do what? To be their junkyard dogs, to go after the Christians and the Jews, to destroy the Judeo-Christian framework of a constitutional republic. That's what I deal with in my docu-movie Siege. And they can watch a whole hour at siegethemovie.com for free, siegethemovie.com. But I've got former CIA sitting at my dinner table saying, Brannon, and these are not evangelicals, by the way, former CIA officers, one on my left, one on my right, saying, Brannon, this is a national security threat, and you'd better wake up the evangelicals because they're being penetrated and flipped at the hand of the Marxists that are using the Islamists as the junkyard dogs to wipe out Christians and Jews in America.
Brannon, I so appreciate what you're saying about focusing on Jesus Christ. I mean, our lives, our ministries ought to be Christ-centered. And you know, for them to take and try to take Jesus Christ and his talk about true love, sacrificial love, and God so loving the world that he would give us Jesus Christ as a free gift of salvation, to try to use that to flip, to persecute us and to get rid of the Judeo-Christian view, it's frightening. And so I guess as we look at this, according to the website now, there are a number of individuals who are associated with very good groups, or at least institutions that used to be very strong Orthodox evangelical institutions. People on the neighborly faith group, such as Chris Stackerook, he's there promoting interfaith programs for emerging faith leaders. And then we see them being connected, though, with these people who are connected with jihadist groups. What are they doing? Where are they finding common ground? And maybe it's hard for you to do this because you don't see it, but what are some of these evangelicals thinking? How do they think this is going to help?
They're not thinking. And this guy that's one of the co-directors is on staff at Moody Bible Institute. Now, I grew up with Moody Monthly coming to my house every month in the 70s. Moody Monthly. I mean, I spoke at Moody Bible Institute in the early 90s. I've spoken on the platform with the past president and then president of Moody Bible, George Sweeting. I mean, this was an institution we all grew up respecting as evangelical Christians, and they're co-director of this group, Neighborly Faith, is on staff at Moody Bible Institute. And we got the Gospel Coalition and other folks involved in this. And by the way, what you need to understand is, which we have not brought up, Neighborly Faith is targeting Christian kids on Christian campuses. You've got Cedarville. You've got Moody Bible. You've got Fuller. You've got all kinds of Christian universities they're going to engage in interfaith dialogue with Jew-hating, Holocaust-denying, Hitler-defending, jihadi-preaching Islamists, and they're doing it on Christian campuses. So they're targeting your Christian kids. I mean, talk about, I think, a real deceptive thing. You offer up thousands of dollars to get your kid a Christian education, and they bring in jihadis? And by jihadis, I mean there's different kinds of jihad. There's jihad as in terrorism, and there's jihad as in cultural jihad. And yet you're paying for your kids to go to a Christian school where they bring in the wolves now to deceive your kids? Seems like to me somebody ought to be getting their money back. But this is going on college, Christian college campuses in America, Neighborly Faith with these people. So what common ground do we have? There is none, zero. And so what has happened is they become so tolerant and so open-minded, their brains have fallen out. But the reality is, how is it that the Marxists, the cultural Marxists, are able to convince the evangelical colleges to do this with the Muslims? Well, that, again, they're using the Marxists, are using the Islamists as the junkyard dog to de-Christianize the West. What did Karl Marx say? My object in life is to dethrone God and destroy capitalism. Let me tell you something. Islam will do that. It will get Americans to worship or agree with the false god of Allah, which is really Satan. And it will, what did he say? My object in life is to dethrone God and destroy capitalism. You know what? Sharia and Marxism will destroy capitalism. That's how they're united, Marxism and Islam. They're united in social justice. Most people don't know that one of the major tenets of Islam is social justice. We know that's a tenet of Marxism, but it's also a tenet of Islam. They're united in their hatred of the Jews and the Christians. They're united in their hatred of national sovereignty. Both Marxist and Islamists want globalism. So you can see how they're united. By the way, they're united in their disrespect of women. Karl Marx called for communal wives. What does Islam call for? You can have up to four wives, not to mention you can have a prostitute for a period of time. So we see how the Islamists and Marxists are united, mostly in their hatred of liberty, freedom, the Jews, and the Christians.
Brannon, what you're talking about and goes to the heart of why we're doing this program, and I'm hoping and praying that those who are viewing it right now understand that the deception that Jesus talked about would involve elements of truth. I have found, Brannon, as you have, that some of the most effective deception is that which contains elements of truth. And in this case, I wanted to look at just one piece here with you. Isaac referred to it, but neighborly love sounds very biblical. In fact, it is a command. I want to be neighborly to my neighbors. I want to be loving to those who are around me who don't know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. But when you put together organizations such as this, and you bring it together, as we said at the beginning, and say that effectively we worship the same God, or we can be equivalent in our faith, or we can't hold to a position that says that there is only one way to heaven, Jesus Christ, because that's too exclusive. Balance here, if you could, just another minute. Put together the element of deception that's so critical. How do we take what the Bible says to be personal commands for us to love our neighbor, and how, when you bring it together organizationally and you go on to church platforms and that kind of thing, that you now cross the line and it becomes error?
Yeah, well, they use scripture out of context. And Leviticus 19, I was a stranger and you welcomed me. That has to do with Jews not lording their Jewishness over non-Jews, and yet they use this for immigration policies in America. We need to welcome the stranger. It has nothing to do with immigration policy. By the way, also, these were people who were worshiping the one true God. Islam is not doing that. They use Matthew 25, I was a stranger, you visited me, you welcomed me. Again, Jesus dividing the sheep from the goats. And by the way, what does he go on to do, Jesus, in Matthew 25? Commend those who did what? Defended these, my brothers. Look at the scripture in context. Who are my brothers? Jews. So how are the Islamists defending the Jews? No, they're calling for the murder of the Jews. So again, they're using scripture out of context. When you really understand it in context, it's actually about Jewish people welcoming those who worship the one true God, not the false God of Islam, and it is commending Jesus, those who took care of the Jews, and Islam seeks to destroy the Jews. So they're using scripture out of context, and the sad thing is people in America and the evangelical world largely don't know how to study the Bible in context. You know, I think it was Mark Twain who said, it's easier to deceive people than to convince them they've been deceived. It's easier to deceive people than to convince them they've been deceived. There's a great deception going on. And this is not only about de-Christianizing the West and using Sharia, Islamic law, to destroy the West and our constitutional republic. It's also about getting Christians to help bring in Islamists to America through George Soros-funded organizations like the Evangelical Immigration Roundtable, which many church denomination leaders and Southern Baptist leaders and others are part of. George Soros has funded this, according to many outlets. And what is their goal? More voters, more voters, more voters. So whether it's the Marxist and the AND campaign or Neighborly Faith, it's about bringing in chaos, disrupting, and bringing in more voters. And so they're using these tactics by co-opting Bible verses out of context, co-opting our terminologies, Jesus, gospel, a kingdom of God, and we need to be people who understand what's going on and not buying the lie. This is all an information operation, psychological warfare, and most people are being deceived. And what's really sad is that we're called intolerant, we're called radical, we're called extreme by simply pointing things out. Why? Because, again, it's easier to deceive people than to convince them they've been deceived. And as a result, you and I become the radicals and extremists when we're trying to warn them about the real radicals and extremists.
Indeed. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to be back in just a moment with some concluding thoughts on how you can fortify yourself so that you are not caught believing a lie.
Stand in the Gap is produced and recorded in the studios of WBPH Philadelphia. Positively different television.
Welcome back to Stand in the Gap, and this is a second program that we've been doing on deception in the church, looking first of all at Marxist groups that are trying to infiltrate Bible-believing churches, and now looking at churches that are being infiltrated with interfaith dialogue, which is actually radical Islamic groups coming into our churches, into our institutions to try to change us. To change our beliefs. And so, Brannon Howse, you've been describing this, you've written on this, you've made a movie on this. What do we do as Bible believers? You said what Mark Twain said about it's easier to deceive people than to convince them that they've been deceived. How do we help the evangelical church keep be fortified against deception and from the lies of Satan?
Proclaim truth, teach truth, practice truth, the key word truth. Jesus said, you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free. We see that in the scriptures again, don't be cheated by the philosophies of men that are not according to Christ. The lie is destroyed with truth. And so many people have at once opposed us and our organization, have only come now back and said in email or handwritten letters, I'm so sorry. I was deceived and I was critical of you. And then I finally listened long enough to understand the truth. And some of those folks have become some of our biggest supporters. So truth is so crucial. That's why I produce books and DVDs, why you put out radio and television. And if they want an hour of free truth, just go to siegethemovie.com, watch 1 hour for free of this 8.5 hour docu movie and understand the truth of what's happening. The spiritual attacks on our country, which are also national security threats. But the lie is destroyed with the truth. Quickly, I will say, we had men that were being brainwashed in our POW, in the POW camps of North Korea. Those who survived knew what they believed, why they believed it. Those who were deceived were those who didn't know the truth, and they were easily taken captive, prisoners of war, literally and spiritually. So the key word here is truth, information. And that's what we're constantly putting out. Documented proof and information to destroy the lies of those who serve the father of lies.
Brannon Howse, thank you for being with us today. God bless you, sir, and your ministry. Ladies and gentlemen, Scripture says, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. That is the truth of God's word. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. There's only one way. It's Jesus Christ. He is the truth. It is in the word of God. I challenge those of you listening to us, know Jesus Christ, your personal Savior. If you don't, make that certain right now. And if you do, read the word of God, study it, memorize it, embrace it, live it out. Teach it to your children. Teach it to your grandchildren. And don't be intimidated to believe that believing in the Bible is somehow wrong. This is what can set us free, and when we share it, can set others free as well. Thank you for watching us today on Stand in the Gap. Communicate it this week, standinthegapmedia.org. Let us know that you are watching. God bless you.